Hey, ladies and gentlemen, we'll call this meeting of Land Use and Transportation to order. Madam Clerk, can you read the continuances and the restriction papers?
Item number one, ordinance number 2011-207, to amend chapter 2, article 5 of the city code by adding sections that concern the slave trail commission. That item has been continued for 60 days. And that's the only change I have for this afternoon.
Okay. I hear a motion that we second all in favor say aye.
Aye.
So move and approve. At this time, we'll open up this for public comment. Those who might speak for the committee, make sure they're in front. Speak. Right, sir. And 3 minutes.
Thank you. My name is Phil Leo, editor of the Virginia Defender newspaper, and one of the people who spent 10 years working to reclaim the Richmond African Burial Ground. And I had come today because there was an article in Sunday's newspaper saying that the Slave Trail Commission is going to reintroduce their paper asking council to authorize the elimination of term limits for its members. Hope you read the article. It lays out pretty well the problems with the Slave Trail Commission, including the fact that apparently only one of its members, Dr. Cynthia Newbill, presently is legally seated on the commission. Everyone else's terms have expired. Some people even serving on the executive board are no longer eligible to be reinstated, reappointed to that board. One of the other things it didn't mention was the fact that if you go on the city's website and look at the expenditures for the Slave Trail Commission, and you deduct the itemized expenditures for these reconciliation statute and the Lumpkins Jail renovation, both of which are very good projects, you'll find that there is quite a bit of money unaccounted for. And it works out to an average of $1,050 per month in expenditures by the Slave Trail Commission. And our organization is preparing a formal request to the city auditor's office to look into this, because if this is money that's being spent, it ought to be accounted for, and it's money being spent by people who are not authorized to be on the board to decide to spend it, that's an even more serious problem. So as the city committee that oversees the Slave Trail Commission, we ask you to please do not solidify a dysfunctional position by agreeing to eliminate term limits on a board which only has one legitimate member. And secondly, please look into the question of expenditures of this committee. The final point is that the Slave Trail Commission for over a year has promised to hold a public meeting to solicit the community's input into how the sacred ground sites of Lumpkins Jail, the African Burial Ground.
You have 30 seconds. Please begin to summarize.
15th Street that had the auction houses should be properly memorialized. They have never done that, and yet they are saying they're moving ahead with creating a foundation to raise millions of dollars to build structures that the community has had no input into. Thank you very much.
Thanks, ma'am. Yeah, you have your
Mr. Chair, I'd just like to ask the gentleman if he would please maybe give my office a call. I'd like to follow this conversation with you.
Absolutely.
Thank you.
Thank you. Are there others who would like to come from the committee?
Important one may have been a miscommunication when we had a discussion with the CAO's office.
there's some great detail about the coop, that it needs to have walls, it needs to have a roof. The fencing slates, not greater than 2 inches apart. But the part about chickens should remain in enclosure at all times. This was going to remain in the enclosure at all times from dusk to dawn. This is to prevent rodents. This is to prevent raccoons, other predators from trying to come in the area of the coop. But to keep a chicken in an enclosed coop with only 3 square feet per chicken, it's not very humane. It's kind of like having a dog and keeping them in a crate 24/7. So we are looking at trying to get the coop for the hens on when it's dark. But during the day, we were hoping that it could be included, that they could free range on your property, as long as you have proper fencing for your yard, that they're not allowed to roam large on the streets, nobody wants that. But that's kind of a humane issue for the pets.
I think probably it'd be a good idea to get Mr. Taylor right here, right? Gentleman right there, and he can get you the correct folks to talk about that. Because they're still working.
Right. And I thought Charles Samuels would be here this evening, and I know he's one of the people that was working on it. And we're pretty strong about this one point that we think was a miscommunication, like I said. Thank you.
Thank you for coming. Okay, are there others that will come for the committee? Seeing none, Madam Clerk, may we have approval of the minutes of the previous meeting?
I need a motion to approve the minutes from the July 17th, 2012 meeting.
Second. All in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Okay, this time we will, I think Mr. Tyler wants to talk to the arts paper. He's not here yet, so we'll kind of hold off on that one for a moment. And I think Mr. Beschler has got a short report. I don't see him out there right now. Anyway, we'll come get him. He's standing here. Hurry up. Madam Clerk, go ahead and read paper number.
Item number 3, ordinance number 2012-162, to authorize the CAO on behalf of the City of Richmond to execute a letter of agreement between the City of Richmond and Norfolk Southern Corporation for the purpose of the City obtaining access to the railroad property and right-of-way to make repairs to the portion of Manchester Bridge located over Norfolk Southern's corporate railroad track and right-of-way.
And
Madam
Clerk, come out reading number 4 as well. These are some.
Item number 4, ordinance 2012-164, to authorize the CAO on behalf of the City of Richmond to execute a construction agreement between the City of Richmond and CXS Transportation Incorporated for the purpose of the City obtaining access to the railroad property and right-of-way in order to make repairs for a portion of Robert E. Lee Bridge.
Okay. So anyway, I'm here to introduce these two papers.
Good afternoon. I'm Bob Benjamin from Public Works. Both of these papers are agreements that the city would need to enter into in order to have access across the railroad companies right away in order to make repairs to the two bridges that we just spoke of, Manchester Bridge and Robert E. Lee Bridge.
Okay. Any questions from Mr. Benjamin? From the committee?
Are these
CIP projects, or are they funded through some state funds?
One's funded through federal funds, the other's funded through state funds, state urban funds.
Okay. Okay.
Okay, is anybody in the public that would like to speak in favor of this paper? Anybody opposed to this paper? No. Okay, I'll bring it back to you.
One other question. The repair work, is that going to require that there's any closing down of the bridges during the period of time for repair? And my question is in relationship to whether or not, what is that procedure for notification if we all going to have to?
Well, the actual construction of both of these projects won't start until sometime in the spring of next year. And some may require some lane closures, but not complete closure of the bridges.
We would, motion to use to the four, both papers to look forward to council with a recommendation for approval, Mr. Chair.
Now, second that, all papers say aye.
Aye.
Do this, forward. Madam Clerk, please read paper number three. Two, five.
Item number five, ordinance 2012-166, to declare public necessity exits and to authorize acquisition by gift, person, combination, or otherwise, for the combination to be in the manner prescribed by the City of Richmond Charter 18.03, a permanent and temporary easements on the properties known as 6001 and 6007 Hope Street Road for the purpose of realignment of Hope Street Road, Hay Road, and Durant Road.
Pamela Porter, Public Works. This paper is to authorize the CAO to use combination action or otherwise to acquire permanent construction easement and a temporary drainage easement at 6001 and 6007 Hope Street Road. A public necessity exists to allow the temporary and permanent access and the use of the property for the realignment of Hay and Durant Road with Hope Street Road, performing standard four-lane intersection. The area is currently an accident-prone intersection with high number of accidents. The cost to the city for the permanent and the temporary easement will be $667. Any questions?
Thank you. Let me speak to this briefly as well. This is my district. This area is a very high traffic area and very unsafe. A lot of accidents there. And we actually are talking to the folks that own the property. We are purchasing 400 square feet of one person's property here. And it seems that we can't get together on any price on the property. We've got several appraisals that we feel are very competitive. Gentleman just does not want to settle. So he's aware that this process is taking place. And I'm sure he's not even here, but he knows about this. So we're going to go ahead and give the problem, move forward, and then it can be worked out later with the documentation that we have. And then in the meantime, next several weeks or a month, he could even settle with us as well. So that's where that's happening. I'll certainly appreciate for you. So any questions? Oh, yes. Any questions? Okay, thank you. Okay, at this time, we'll turn this over to public comment. Are there others here today who speak in favor of this paper? And there's anybody here that speak in opposition to paper, I guess. In favor or opposition?
I have a clarifying question. My name is Silver Bursinger. I'm a citizen of Richmond, Virginia. I'm wondering why you all are using condemnation process rather than right of eminent domain, which is what the government has. And if the property really isn't condemnable, I don't see why you're using this process. Thank you for the opportunity to comment.
It's a good question. Legal, you want to still here to answer that question? I don't think that's not an unfair question. Let's go ahead and do item number seven next.
163, to amend and restore ordinance number 8260-8041, adopted March 9th, 1981, concerning the Bowel Oaks Community Unit Plan to amend the permanent uses to include an adult care resident use and to establish the number of permitted adult care resident dwelling units.
We have anybody here to introduce who we are? Ms. Marco.
Good afternoon, Marie Marco with the Department of Planning and Development Review. This paper would amend an existing community unit plan. The Beaufort Oaks Community Unit Plan is consists of multifamily apartments and some elderly housing units behind Chippenham Hospital off of High Oaks Road. When the community unit plan was first adopted, it treated all of the residential units as multifamily units. At that time, there was not a separate definition for units that serve an elderly population or that are specific for disabled or adult care units. So this ordinance would amend the CUP to specify that a certain number of adult care units would be permitted. It would separate them from the multifamily units. It would authorize an additional 10 units. The applicant wishes to convert some of the existing adult care units into units that would serve memory impaired, which means that they are removing some kitchen facilities from the units and would no longer meet the normal definition of multifamily units, but would be considered the adult care units. And so that is what the proposed ordinance would do, would authorize these adult care units and authorize an additional 10 units in the entire facility.
This is also in my district. We have no pushback.
The Planning Commission did review the proposal at their meeting on September 4th and recommended approval.
Do you have any questions? Okay, thank you. Okay, let's turn this over to the public. Does anybody here would like to speak in favor of this paper? Does anybody here want to speak in opposition to this paper? Not to bring it back to the committee.
So, would you go forward, Mr. Chair, the recommendation for approval to council?
Just a second. Okay. Okay, all in favor say aye.
Aye.
Okay, Madam Clerk, I'll move that forward. Let's do number 8 next.
Item number 8, resolution number 2012-R116. To rename a portion of the street named Lock Lane by resolution number 88R201218, adopted September 26, 1988, between Grove Avenue and Carey Street as East Lock Lane, the portion of the street renamed Lock Lane by resolution number 88R201218.
Do we have anybody here to present this paper?
Good afternoon. Mark Bollinger, Department of Planning and Development Review. Quick history on this. Back in 1988, there was a paper adopted that made some changes to the names of Lock Lane from Carey to its southern terminus. Since that adoption in 1988, it became clear that those changes were not instituted, that we got East Lock Lane, North Lock Lane South, an old Lock Lane. Became an issue with delivery potentially of some emergency services. Became an issue with getting people from point A to point B, so we decided to clean it up and create an East Lock Lane, a Lock Lane, and the 400 block of Old Lock Lane, which is the only portion of Old Lock Lane that has residential uses on it. Get this thing cleaned up once and for all, get the spelling correct, get the directions right, and make sure that the people can get the delivery of the emergency services.
Any questions?
No.
All right, thank you.
Thank you.
All right, let's turn it over to the public. Is anybody here to speak in favor of this paper? Is anybody here in opposition to this paper? Okay, Seeing none, bring it back to committee. Motion, make a motion to move forward to council for approval.
Second.
All in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Okay, Madam Clerk, move that forward. See, Mr. Tyler is not here yet. Why don't we read paper number six?
Item number six, ordinance number 2012-141, to amend and reordain chapter 4, article 1 of the city code by adding new sections number 14 through 16 through 14 through 22, and to amend and reordain chapter 98, article 3, division 1 of the city code by adding therein a new section number 98-99, both for the purpose of establishing a derelict building abatement program in accordance with Virginia code.
Is there anybody here to introduce this paper?
Mr. Chair, I would ask if Mr. Dunlap would be willing to help me out with the introduction of this paper. As we are aware, we just in this past year was only was able to get legislation passed in regards to receivership as a tool to help us in addressing blight properties that create a major challenge for us in the city. This paper is in some ways one of the first initiatives that we need to put in place to move forward with the full implementation of receivership. And it pretty much mirrors legislation that has been introduced by other cities. There are some concerns that have been brought to my attention by Carr, I think, that is concerned about the provision in the paper that addresses allowing a property owner whose property will have been declared derelict to present a plan to the city for the improvement of that, bringing that property, restoring that property, or and it also provides provisions for some demolition. And so if we had a meeting a couple Saturdays ago in which we had the legal office as well as economic and planning office there, community development, to give the community a full appreciation for all of the components of the legislation, what's the purpose of the legislation, and how this legislation would be used to help us review the derelict properties in the city. Mr. Dunlap was there and was a part of that panel discussion with the community, and so I would ask him if he would please to just share maybe the specifics of this legislation from the U.S. perspective.
My name is Dennis Lindrup, and I'm the Deputy Director of the Department of Planning and Development Review. As the councilperson has stated, this is legislation that supports the city's initiative to begin to transform neighborhoods and address blight and derelict properties throughout. The proposed ordinance is again being put in place as a precursor to the receivership ordinance that will follow soon after. Receivership will give the city the ability to take control of the properties, not ownership, but take control of the properties and to do the work that is necessary to bring it up to the standards as stated in state building code. So while there are a couple of items listed within the ordinance as incentives for the program, that will be attached to the ordinance. The real thinking is that this is a necessary step in order to get us to receivership. And I have a copy of the receivership ordinance with me, and within that, the third item that's listed indicates that pursuant locality has to
pursuant to code 10.2, line 07.1, in order for the city to move forward with acting and receiving the property the locality has to prove and declare such a property be blighted in compliance with the provisions of spotlight abatement program. And that also ties back to, again, the receivership program. It must be considered derelict. We already have a spotlight process in place. That ordinance was passed several years ago, and we actually closed on our first spotlight property on this year. The second piece to that, again, is to also have the derelict policy or ordinance in place so that we can actually receive the property. So,
any questions?
Questions?
This may be getting too far afield. The owners of the derelict property, if they put in an abatement plan, they will be offered the opportunity, should they decide to take it, to enjoy the same benefits of the tax abatement program that other areas of the city can enjoy, but for a lesser amount of time. It's 5 years instead of 10 years. Is that right?
No, that's correct.
Okay. Is there any concern that this may encourage those properties on the cusp to just let them go derelict so that they can get this benefit?
No, I don't think that would be the case. We had a conversation with the assessor's office. We had a round table. Members of the administration representing several departments and the assessor's office view the ordinance as written. Again, it follows the line of state statute in a couple of instances, and that one in particular, we looked at whether or not we might be able to adjust it so that it was in line with the program that we already have in place at citywide. And what we were advised by legal is that we could not do that because then it would not be allowed in the state statute.
Is it also in the state statute that we have to refund 50% of the building and permit fees?
Yes, it is.
Okay. And then lastly, they put in an abatement plan, but don't follow it. It's a class 2 misdemeanor. For each day, it looks like there's a remaining violation. Have you all discussed with the police or another enforcement agency how those class 2 warrants are going to be issued?
No, we have not. The police department was not part of that discussion.
Okay. Thank you.
Ms. Roger, do you have any questions?
Yeah, let me just unfortunately I just received this email or letter, I should say, from I
so that you understand, when we talk about rebating costs associated with demolition permits, I think that the permit for demolition of a residential property is $100, and demolition for a commercial property is $150. So, I mean, if you're talking about rebating $100 or $150, I don't think that decision is going to be made based on the fact that you're going to receive a check back from the city for $100.
But it is a rebate.
It is a rebate. So the work has to be done, and a number of our programs are structured in that way, as a rebate.
Okay, I'm sure there are other questions that may come up as it relates to the statute and the state requires. But I think what is important, Mr. Chair, is that we have identified how many vacant properties that we would consider as either potentially derelict or blighted in the city, throughout the city. That count has been anywhere from a couple thousand and less. So this is a major problem for the city. And as a prerequisite for some of the other tools that we want to be able to use to move forward with strategy for redeveloping our communities and redeveloping housing in our communities, this is a prerequisite. It's my understanding that we would need to have in place.
Any other questions?
Okay, at this time we will put it out for public comment. Are there people here that would like to speak in favor of this paper? Are there people here that would like to speak in opposition to the paper?
Mr. Chair, Jack Pearsall, I'm a member of the Commission of Architecture Review. We're fully aware of the derelict buildings in Richmond. We agree it is a big problem. We just think it's using the wrong technique to get out. Number one, yes, this is necessary to be adopted in all of state law to allow you to adopt the receivership ordinance. But the two are in parallel. We would like you to hold up this one until you've got the receivership ordinance ready to go. Second, this is way too loose. We're concerned that the thousands of buildings that are vacant could be swept in with this. Number one, you say might endanger public health, safety, or welfare. We'd ask you to say it must be considered to endanger public health, safety, and welfare. Second, we'd like to see that this has already been cited for blight. Third, we'd like to see that it has had a violation notice requiring it to be either boarded up or torn down. The typical orange-red sticker that goes on the door. So that we're not just faced with a situation where the many houses throughout the poorer neighborhoods would be subject to this, and then an owner who's let it go for years because it wouldn't pay him to fix it up. He's getting too little rent to justify fixing it up. That person is not going to then come to the city in 90 days with a rehab program. He's going to take the easy way out, and he's going to ask for demolition permit and go ahead with the demolition. We're greatly concerned that if this is the only ordinance adopted and it doesn't have those further restrictions in it as to when it applies, that we will see wholesale spot demolitions block after block ending up with empty lots. And as you know, that's the worst kind of city neighborhood. The minute the snaggle teeth start showing up, the neighborhood declines. So we, as the Commission of Architectural Review, are very concerned that in our old historic districts, we'll start seeing that kind of spot losses, spot demolitions, because it's not an equal choice. When you look at it, it's far favorable for the man or person who has the ability to let it go and then to demolish it. It doesn't have to do with getting the rebate, it has to do with the cost. $50,000 to $70,000 to rehab something as opposed to $5,000 to $20,000 to demolish it. It's a no-brainer. And then you add on to that, that he's going to be facing huge fines daily and a class 2 misdemeanor. I predict for you, you're going to see a rush for the records board. And the best thing this council would do would be wait until it's got the demolition ordinance ready. Put the more red teeth in this ordinance. You can't cut below what the state law permits, but you can put higher restrictions on yourself. You can require a higher threshold before the building is eligible under this ordinance. And that's what we would ask.
There are others?
Silver Person, citizen of Richmond, Virginia. I would like to second the gentleman from the Commission for Architectural Review. I share his concerns, and I don't want to see a lot of old houses in Richmond torn down when it really should be renovated. Thank you.
Okay, seeing no more public comment, I'll bring it back to the committee. There's a discussion.
I have not put in an ordinance for the receivership authority. Do we know if that paper is in the works by any other council members?
It is my understanding that I've had a conversation with the attorneys as it relates to us beginning the process of pulling that legislation together. I don't know what the status of it is.
Would Ms. Robinson, your concern be with holding this up? That we're holding up the ability to rehab these properties?
Well, you know, whereas this paper is necessary as it relates to support the receivership legislation, and I understand it certainly can operate independent of it on its own. And whereas owners will not be coming to the city and asking us to declare their properties derelict. This would be proactive from the city's perspective to go after properties, to identify those properties as far as being derelict. So I think the flood of people running to the door for this opportunity is somewhat, I don't know that that has been the case. We did a lot of, had a lot of conversations with Norfolk that have this legislation in place and have had it in place for quite some time and have demonstrated how this legislation has been very meaningful and very helpful for them as a strategic tool to be able to use in redevelopment areas where there are properties that within these conditions. And it has been very meaningful for them in their process of getting the renovation done. There have been times where there's been demolition, and they recognize that in a lot of cases, we have houses in our communities that have been sitting abandoned and vacant I can speak of my community, you know, where I live, you know, that for 50 plus years, the cost of, and I did renovation of old houses as a part of my career before I came to council. And it is extremely expensive, and some of it doesn't make sense when you had a house that has been sitting vacant in the neighborhood for, 50, 75 years. And in some cases, it is necessary to do demolition. I'm a lover of old houses, and I've renovated some old houses, but I've asked myself, why did I do this, because of the cost that is associated with it, and without certain kinds of grants and other kinds of things to make that happen, it would have been impossible to restore some of the old houses. I am more than willing to meet with, like I said, I just received this letter of opposition. I just learned as of yesterday evening late from Mr. Taylor that there was some expression of opposition. I don't have the second page, the back page of your letter, so I would love to get a copy of the back page as well, so I have the full document. And I welcome the opportunity to have a discussion on this. One of the things that we had hoped to do when we had the discussion a couple of Saturdays ago was that people from the industry, from the housing is old historic homes. There are a lot of things we can compete with the county with and not compete. But one thing we do have that they don't have as an inventory is our old homes. So, you know, I don't know that, you know, continuing this to the next meeting is going to be an impediment to what we are trying to do with the receivership legislation. And I will push forward, Mr. Sanders, with the receivership legislation as part of this process as well. And what I would like to ask is perhaps the administration would join in with me, Mr. Dunlap, and we would more than happy to have a roundtable discussion with stakeholders over this legislation and if there's ways that we can show that we would have to do that.
Well, then,
do I have
a motion to continue?
Yes.
I'll second that. All in favor say aye.
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 That paper has been continued. Okay, let's see. I guess we'll go back to paper number two.
Item number two, ordinance 2012-4, to amend ordinance 973-41, adopted January 27, 1997, which adopted a process to be followed to ensure funding for the 1% for art programs to be administered by the Public Art Commission.
We have somebody to present.
Yeah.
additional meeting, but I would like to, I like Mr. Child think that we should have public art is very important. But if we have, we do have limited resources in the city, and I would like to see us come to some kind of solution to this problem, maybe together.
Yeah, this is going off for a motion.
Okay, second. Okay, we've got the motion, it's been seconded, all the members say aye.
Aye.
Okay, we've got the vote, the case will be continued.
And would also ask that the clerk find the document that was being referenced to you.
If we can follow up on that, okay. Okay, at this point, we've got a board's word. Before we do that, Mr. Messner is going to give us a quick update on the fleets. On the fleets. He doesn't have a PowerPoint, he told me he would be briefing us.
Good afternoon, my name is Chris Messner. Chairman Connor, remarks are going to be brief. The reason for that is we are still in an open curve, and of course, I'm bound by the open confidentiality that I took. However, I believe that I can give this body enough information to give some ideas to the direction that the city is going with respect to fleet. What we'd like to say is we believe that we're very close to the end of the process, and we believe that by the time this committee convenes next month, that we will have finished the process. Number two is we do believe that having outside vendors will help the city gain some efficiencies in the maintenance of fleet. So we've been going through negotiations, and tomorrow close of business, the final proposals are due. The evaluation committee will be evaluating them, and we are hopeful that we will be able to come to an agreement help us find efficiencies in certain areas of our fleet program.
Any questions for this question? No. Okay, that concludes. Thank you very much, Mr. Special.
Thank you for that.
Okay, at this time, Madam Clerk, let's talk about the board vacancies.
This afternoon's board vacancies, we have a lot of reappointment applications. On the first page, we have the Building Code Board of Appeals, the General Division. And we have reappointment applications for Thomas Davis, John Bach, William LaFoon, James Sonoya, and Nelson Williams.
Okay. What's the committee think about that? They're all like reappointed.
So these are all vacancies that are eligible, and all of these are eligible for reappointment?
Yes, ma'am.
Is that right? Mm-hmm. Ms. Hamilton, okay. All right, let's move this forward. Let's ask the Planning Commission for a moment. Clean City Commission.
I'd make a motion to move that one forward. That's the second issue, of course, for the change of issues.
Okay, so we'll move Clean City Commission first forward. Next one, Madam Clerk.
Commission of Architectural Review, one reappointment application for Matthew Helms. I also included all other applicants who applied.
This committee will take a look at those and see what your thoughts are. They asked to screen these people for us, or the design committee did. Cheryl, can I have a point?
So these are their recommendations based on their screening?
Yes, ma'am.
And I can, also do another brain development and, talk to Brandon about that direction with them that lead me to move the BX initiatives.
All agree, move those forward. Adam Kirk and him will make sure that, and the committee make sure that we bring these before organizational development in October. If we don't, you know, we're supposed to have a retreat, but if we don't, then in my opinion, it's going to be like January. Hopefully we can get these out there and our organizational development. Now, if we want to go back.
It's up there on the hallway.
We have a paperwork on the board of housing.
For housing trust fund?
Yeah.
We have a board, we have recommendations. We had these recommendations that we were going to consider in the council organization committee meeting and was asked that we take it up in land use.
So I can go through each committee that we have, like, for the housing packet? The first applicant is Regina Chaney. Now with the job, they currently work in a title. The meet criteria I put whether they met the criteria, they lived or worked in the city, and all of the other criteria that the paper required. And I also put the possible qualification that they could fall under in regards to the paper, and then the page number of the application. Council is selecting 7 members, and the mayor has 6. Each 7 members of the Affordable Housing Trust Fund Advisory Board have a certain qualification. 1, a licensed in practice and attorney. 1, a real estate and finance professional with experience overseeing affordable housing. 3, a real estate professional, builder, or developer. 4, personal experience managing affordable housing or mixed income. 5, a representative or an organization that's primary mission is to promote fair housing standards. 6, a representative of an organization or community group that advocates on behalf of low-income residents. And 7, a tenant of a residential property located in the city. So you'll see in the qualification category, when I looked at the applications, I put the possible qualification or category they would fit in. Some people have multiple years of experience working in affordable housing, and you'll see where I say, yes, they meet the qualifications. I put that they could fit in multiple categories, just depending on councils and the committee's will and in what category they would want the person to fit in because of their experience. And you can see that on the application. We also had 2 candidates that actually served on the first advisory board that reapplied, and they've been in it since the beginning. That's Monique Johnson and Andrew Nee. So I contacted all the members of the Affordable Housing Trust Fund Advisory Board that were previously on the board, and anybody who ever had applied for the board. I contacted everyone so they could reapply for this new board.
So you're saying that Ms. Johnson and Mr. Lee were the only ones on the original board that decided to serve on this one, did I hear you correctly?
Yes. Those are the only 2 people I reached out to that were interested in reapplying and we got applications for before the August 31st deadline that we set.
Ms. Johnson, you know these folks?
Monique Johnson has
deal with.
Question, would you be putting her under the category number two, real estate finance professional, et cetera?
I would say yes. She works with several of the different, she's worked in different components of the company. Yes.
Okay. And then, Mr. Nee, is there anybody arguing he's the only attorney?
There is
a second attorney
there. I don't know Mr. Nee as well, but I do know Orbit Fountain, who's with Harold James. And he has quite a bit of background in working with affordable housing. Matter of fact, he served as attorneys for several of the nonprofit organizations, and at one time was also associate director of one of the nonprofits, and has lots of hands-on experience with that as well.
We have any other questions for Ms. Charleston? I think these all look like very good people. I certainly don't have any issues with any of them.
Madam Clerk, none of the positions nor the ordinance mandated that you couldn't have a contract with the city, right?
No.
Okay.
And on the applications, I think you see they list if they have any associated contracts with the city.
Can we move this thing?
to look at their applications. These were just the qualifications that I initially saw that they met. If you know them personally, then you might know something they did. Let's go with the application.
Lead householder is a person with experience transferring for the multifamily. Very interested in serving because they specialize in assisting low-income families that are already living in their homes, which is sometimes we look at building new houses and so forth. So this is fresh, and I think he would bring a different level of diversity to that discussion.
So far I got moved forward with Regina Cheney. She's a representative of an organization with primary mission to promote fair housing. I got moved forward with Joyce Knight, the tenant of the residential property. We're moving forward with Monique Johnson, a real estate and finance professional. We haven't decided which attorney. Are we going to move forward with Andrew Lee or Aubrey Johnson?
I think both of them probably do a great job. I've got votes with Mr. Lee, but I am familiar with Mr. Fountain.
No, kind of. I would do that in reverse.
Okay.
So
you want Mr. Neal? I'm fine with it, but I mean, I think both of these law firms are well established law firms in the city. I would assume that Mr. Fountain just came forward and expressed an interest in serving the firm.
Yes, ma'am.
Yes.
Regina Chaney, a representative of an organization, Joyce Knight, tenant of a residential property, Monique Johnson, real estate finance professional, Andrew Lee, a licensed and practicing attorney, Robert Adams, he fits in several categories, let me see which one is missing. Derek McDaniels, a person experienced managing affordable mixed income family housing, and Lee Householder.
What kind of thing?
All right.
Okay, one, you gave the back, it was the Richmond City Planning Commission. And it looks like we've got Doug Cole from the department and Merrill McAteer.
Both of those speaking?
Yeah, they were tough to be informed. I think, Ms. Andrews might go ahead and okay the board to do Merrill McAteer forward. We would like to reconsider this call. There's reason to hold it back for a moment until we can do a little more research.
Just, I don't know what to say to you about it right now.
So I think it's a fair.
Well, I support both of them, but I'm willing to wait until Ms. Andrews finds comfort with that. That's fine.
Okay. Madam Clerk, let's go ahead and move this McAteer forward, and we'll just hold off on the call.
Okay.
I don't know, my dad.
Yes.
And
at public safety, we discussed the items that were suggested for the legislative package from the safety, public safety committee. One of the things that we're going to do at that retreat, the first Monday in October, along with budget, we're also going to discuss the legislative package so that we can begin to prepare getting it to our delegation. And so, obviously, it might be helpful if you include some of the recommendations in terms of this is a good idea, maybe we should do this, or just at least be familiar with the recommendations.
So you're saying that we should approve these and move these onto that meeting?
I think you should at least have the discussion because we are going to be discussing those at the retreat. And there are some that are specific, I don't have it in front of me, but there are some specific to what I use.
Yeah, I see this. It's broken now. Okay. Any discussion? Do you want to discuss this? So I guess we're going to go ahead and read these.